All right, so I want to start talking about gravity and the nature of gravity and just how gravity works, how we understand gravity. And that's going to take a while. It's going to take more than one video to explore this because I really think it's so easy to just say the easy thing about general relativity, our modern picture of gravity, and just say, oh, matter tells space-time how to bend, and the bending of space-time tells matter how to move. And then that's it. And that's totally accurate. That's a pithy summary of how gravity works, at least in our modern understanding. But there's so much rich nuance that gets lost in that quick little summary. And so I want to take this video and probably the next few videos, really, to explore all the little wrinkles of gravity, pun intended, and to see this masterpiece that Einstein himself created in the early 20th century. And I actually want to start by following Einstein's thought process. He didn't just wake up one day and boom, there's general relativity. It took him 7 years. 7 years of brilliant insights and blood and sweat, working hard and blind alleys, and like he almost gave up a few times. And there was one point where he was super, super close to having general relativity right there in his hands. He was like two lines away, and then he was stuck on some concept and he couldn't get past it for another 2 years. Then finally it cracked and he was able to figure out what it all means, how to piece it all together. And I think it's a wonderful journey, and so I want to share that journey. And I think it's an excellent way to approach a full understanding of general relativity. I think following Einstein's path, because Einstein had so many brilliant insights, that we can pull from that and really explore what this theory means. And I want to start in 1907. 1907 was just a couple years after Einstein had figured out special relativity and a whole bunch of other things, which are totally different episodes. And special relativity was on the scene. Everyone had kind of understood that special relativity was a big deal, even though they hadn't quite worked out all the full implications of that theory. Special relativity is a big deal because it deals with motion. It describes how things ought to move relative to other things. And that is so fundamental, that is so core, that in order for you to have a physical theory, in order for you to have a theory of physics in any field, in any branch, it doesn't matter what you're applying that theory to, it must be compatible with special relativity, because special relativity tells us about time and space and motion and relative distances and relative times and all that good stuff. So if you want a theory, it must be compatible with special relativity. It's almost like a meta theory. It tells you how theories ought to be constructed. So once special relativity is on the scene, you can start looking around like all the other theories out there. What works? What doesn't work? What do we have to modify? What do we have to discard? Well, there's electromagnetism, brought to us by James Clerk Maxwell in the mid-1800s. And James Clerk Maxwell accidentally wrote down, without ever intending to, wrote down a theory that's compatible with special relativity. In fact, that was the genesis of Einstein's thought process that led to special relativity, and that's another episode. So electromagnetism, totally legit. Thermodynamics, you know, some modest modifications, you can make it work. Quantum mechanics, which was being developed at the same time. Paul Adrian Maurice Dirac would eventually marry quantum mechanics with special relativity, and that was fine. Led to some very cool results, by the way. But then there was gravity, right? Newton's gravity is fundamentally incompatible with special relativity in a bunch of ways. And one of the big ways is that in order for Newton's gravity to work, the effects of gravity have to be felt instantaneously. That if you took away the sun, or you moved the sun, or you did something, the Earth would immediately have a different trajectory, which it can't propagate faster than the speed of light. Special relativity tells us that, so that's out. And also, In order for Newton's theories to make sense, there has to be an absolute frame of reference. There has to be some master clock out there, some master ruler out there that is keeping track, keeping time, keeping everything measured. And so you always have that absolute reference frame out there to compare all motion against so you can write down Newton's equations. But special relativity says there is no master clock, there is no master ruler. That is not a part of our universe. Everything is relative, and Newton's equations are incompatible with it. So it has to go. Newton has to go. What are we going to replace it with? That was what a bunch of people were thinking about after special relativity, Einstein included. And the surprising thing is you can make some relatively modest modifications to Newton's equations of gravity and get something that's compatible with special relativity. It's actually not so hard, but those theories lead to some incredibly undesirable consequences, like different masses will fall under these modified theories, will fall at slightly different accelerations, which violate what we know from going all the way back to Galileo. But the effects are so small, oh, we just haven't been able to measure it yet. That was the argument in the early 20th century. Or objects will have different fall rates, different accelerations depending on their horizontal amount of travel, which again violates Newton in a very, very fundamental way. It violates Galileo in a very, very fundamental way. And again, the argument was, oh, these effects are so tiny, we just haven't measured it yet. But extending Newton to be compatible with special relativity ain't that big a deal. Einstein wasn't buying it. He wasn't buying it. He thought something was up. He thought there was something deeper going on. And he was looking around for insights. So like, you know, what is the core idea? What can I take away from Galileo, from Newton, from all the classical theories of gravity? And he hit on this concept of the equivalence principle. This is perhaps the most fundamental principle in all of studies of gravity. And it comes about in Newton's work as this strange, strange quirk that there's really, when we talk about mass, when we talk about the mass of an object, there's really two measures of mass. There's two things, but we're so used to them being the same, we don't think about it anymore, but they don't have to be the same. These two measures, one is the inertial mass. You know, F equals ma, force equals mass times acceleration. That tells you the mass that goes in there is called the inertial mass. It's how much oomph it takes to move an object. If you've got a small object with small inertial mass, you could just flick it and it'll go. If you have a large object with a lot of inertial mass, you have to really push it to get it going, right? Well, that's one sense of mass that we're all totally used to. There's another sense of mass, the gravitational mass, the mass that goes into the equations of gravity, of universal gravitation under Newton. It's almost like the gravitational charge of how much an object responds to the presence of a gravitational field. Something with a lot of gravitational mass will generate a strong gravitational field, and if it's in the presence of some other gravitating mass, it will fall, be attracted to that mass really, really well, really easily. If there's not a lot of gravitational mass, well, then it'll just want to coast along. In order for Newton's equations to work, and this is the weirdest thing, inertial mass and gravitational mass have to be the exact same thing. And there's no reason why they should be. Why is it? Why is it? If you imagine an object falling from the ground, and it falls at a certain rate, a certain fixed acceleration, and then you take an object that's twice as massive. Well, it has twice as much inertial mass, which means it's twice as hard to pull down, but it also has twice as much gravitational mass, which means gravity acts on it exactly twice as well. And so these cancel out perfectly, and the acceleration is constant. This is what Galileo discovered. This is what Newton put into his equations. He didn't know. He didn't know why the inertial mass and the gravitational mass had to be the exact same thing. Einstein didn't know either. Einstein didn't know why there was this equivalence between these two kinds of masses that have absolutely no reason to be the same. So he took it one step further. and just said, I'm going to make it be equal. I'm just going to declare it to be equal. I'm going to elevate it to the level of a principle and just say, you know what? These two measures of mass are going to be the exact same thing. And I'm not going to try to explain it. I'm not going to try to understand it. I'm not going to try to sweep it under the rug. I'm just going to declare it to be true. I'm going to make a fundamental assumption about the universe that inertial mass and gravitational mass are identical. And then we'll go from there. We'll take that as a bedrock cornerstone principle and use that to see if we can learn any cool insights about the world. And what those insights are going to have to wait till the next video. So see you next time. If you like this, please don't forget to hit like. Visit patreon.com/pmsutter to help support making all these videos possible. And subscribe if you haven't. And do the little notification-y thingy too. Whatever. Just do whatever you want.